York has been called the center of the known universe, a city based on the notion of cooperative diversity, fed by the dreams of two centuries of immigrant culture. As people passed through the portals of Ellis Island to take a chance on the American dream, New York became a cradle for a new life. As a result, the city's image is forever linked to the bittersweet dramas of families who took a brisk walk off the edge of the old world and into the new, a land of opportunity and adventure. Throughout the first half of the 20th century, the spirit was embodied in the person of Al Smith, a born politician who rose from local office to become governor of New York in 1918. He was a symbol of the little guy with more moxie than money. He came from the streets of the Lower East Side, and like the city itself, he was everybody's pal.
Falling down, boys and girls together, me and Mamie O'Rourke, we trip the light fantastic on the sidewalks of New York.
Al Smith could identify with the social challenges of early immigrant life.
When I was a boy, we had no playground and very few parks. But we had something else. In its time, just as good, and that was the waterfront. Swimming in the summertime, no small little pool.
Smith's personality promoted a sense of common accomplishment. That was the key to maintaining the vitality of the modern urban experience which New York pioneered. He was the primary link to the cacophony of culture that exploded during the Jazz Age, when New York had its own aggressive sense of style, recreation, and celebration of music and art. And the scandalous dancing of Josephine Baker put the world on notice that anything goes. The city was constantly reinventing itself in bolder and broader forms. Throughout his career, Al Smith seemed to integrate these elements into a singular brash personality.
He asked me what I thought about the New Deal, and I didn't know whether he'd catch it or not, but I told him I didn't think it was so hot.
Smith reflected the kind of audacious attitude that had earlier prompted the community to conceive and build such grand projects as the famous mass transit system, the Brooklyn Bridge, and the sprawling commercial districts where the heart of the city beats its most furious rhythms. Eventually, New York attracted too many dreamers, over 7 million by the turn of the century. The city desperately needed room to grow. It was the architect's challenge to find a way, and Al Smith was determined to make it happen. As the 20th century exploded on the scene, New York became the acknowledged business capital of the world. Thousands of new enterprises vied for position, but with only 22 square miles available on Manhattan, the city was soon bursting skyward from its bedrock foundations. Increased building height demanded stronger structural support. Brick and mortar were replaced by steel beams and rivets. By 1903, early high-rise projects like the Flatiron Building reached the dizzying height of 20 stories.
The Flatiron Building was a very intense effort to build a skyscraper fitting a very singular site. And it was really thought by many people that the building would blow over in a high wind, although of course it was steel construction, it wasn't going to blow over at all. But it was a thrilling building in its day. Steel frame, but clad in stone, very handsome and proving that the skyscraper was well worth developing.
The new steel frame construction ensured that buildings like the Flatiron would not topple in stiff winds. Architects began to realize that 20th century design would be more functional than ornamental. There were other problems associated with big buildings, including integrated heating, lighting, and water installations that could handle the demands of many occupants. Architects now had to design systems versus just aesthetics, and they had to resolve the most daunting dilemma of all. How would people walk up all those stairs?
There's no way anything of any major significance could have been built in height without the elevator. It's kind of tough convincing people to walk up 100 stories. So the elevator is of more than casual consequence.
The evolution of the elevator is a classic example of American ingenuity. In 1852, an obscure engineer named Elisha Otis invented a unique new hoisting machine. Originally designed for freight and animals, it was eventually adapted for lifting people. In May of 1854, P.T. Barnum himself invited Otis to the first World's Fair in New York's Crystal Palace to demonstrate his invention. As an astonished crowd watched in horror, Otis rode his safety hoister up and down, then dramatically severed the rope that supported the box he was riding. But instead of falling to his death, the box came to a gentle stop. He had also invented a fail-safe braking device. The world took notice, and the Otis elevator was born. Meanwhile, architects realize that all the usual dangers that threaten a building's welfare are magnified in large buildings, particularly the threat of fire. New York's biggest buildings often housed sweatshops, dark, dirty secret factories of the garment trade. Here, women and children worked long hours for meager wages in a kind of industrial hell. In 1911, disaster struck when New York's Triangle Shirtwaist Factory caught fire. The firemen fought into the night to a chorus of screams from women dying inside. Of 148 victims, scores were suffocated or burned beyond recognition, trapped in a poorly designed building with inadequate exits and narrow hallways. Others in terror leapt to their death on the sidewalk below as teams of rescue workers stood helplessly nearby. Al Smith personally conducted the accident investigation and introduced legislation that would create safer zoning regulations for large structures. But not everyone was reassured. After all, there was something menacing about the stature of big buildings. They seemed to overpower people like some science fiction prophecy come true. Were we really entering the ominous future proclaimed by Fritz Lang's terrifying Metropolis? What will the world be like when buildings grew so large they blocked out the sun? This fear led to more zoning regulations and to architectural setbacks in a building's design, ensuring a progressively narrower structure as more height was achieved, and guaranteeing pedestrians a view of the sky. After the technical issues of construction had been addressed, the main reason for New York finally adopting the concept of tall buildings was the egos of the men who wanted them built. After all, the largest buildings in a city are always the ones that hold the greatest power. In the past, houses of worship owned the skyline, but in 1913, New York developed a broader interpretation of the theme. Frank Woolworth spent his own nickel's dimes to create an ornate 60-story Gothic structure that lay claim to the mantle of the world's tallest building.
And the Woolworth Building remains the most romantic of all the buildings. It does what a skyscraper ought to do, which was to aspire to heaven, to go up and up and up, and to be like a cathedral. And therefore it was chosen to have bestowed on it a kind of Gothic dress, and people thought of it as a cathedral, but a cathedral of commerce instead of a cathedral of religion.
Suddenly, the race was on among the rich and powerful to build the ultimate edifice in the modern age of business titans. A new word was coined for these ambitious spires to the clouds: skyscraper, a term previously reserved for tall ships. Architects reveled in their new notoriety, throwing wild costume parties where they would lay claim to their audacious design achievements. In 1929, there were over 700 buildings that were at least 20 stories tall. New York was fast becoming an armada of skyscrapers, but storm clouds were rising on Wall Street. There were rough seas ahead. The architect of the Empire State Building could not attend the dedication of the building. Instead, he sent a telegram from his ship en route to England. "One day out, and I can still see the building." Modern marvels will return in a moment. The 1920s were a time to throw caution to the wind with wild, exuberant abandon. The greatest irony of the Roaring Twenties was prohibition, a nationally sanctioned moral hypocrisy.
Alcohol is hindering the coming of world peace because it is befuddling the thinking of humanity.
People were labeled by their position on the issue of alcohol. Some were considered dry, others who openly endorsed consumption were called wet. Al Smith was wet.
I will not be influenced in appointments by the question of a person's wet or dry attitude.
And that was a factor in his losing the 1928 presidential election to Herbert Hoover. Smith had linked all his political ambitions to the race for the White House, so that for the first time in 25 years, he was out of public office. But these were the Roaring Twenties, and the music played on. Mass production was in full swing. People danced. Bootleg booze was flowing like tap water. People danced. The jazz sound drew a sharp cultural line between generations. People danced. But when Wall Street collapsed, the dancing stopped. The Depression brought a grinding halt to any sort of festivities and an abrupt end to New York's high-rise building boom. The situation in New York was particularly bleak. You can't grow food on a concrete landscape. You can't find work when business has collapsed. People hoped for signs that this was only a temporary setback, that the grand proposition called the American Dream wasn't a paper moon over a cardboard sea. As both a commercial venture and an investment in the resilient spirit of New York, the few men who had money defied the Depression and hired the scrappy Al Smith to spearhead the greatest urban construction project ever. Their plan was to erect the world's largest building as a practical monument to a culture they hoped would weather the hard times. The design came from New York architect William Lamb, who was asked a simple question: how big can you build it so it won't fall down? John Raskin, founder of General Motors and primary backer of the project, suggested a design based on the shape of the thick pencils favored by their young children. Lamb's final design incorporated this idea. They would call it the Empire State, New York's traditional nickname. It would become a legend.
The site of the Empire State Building is, or was, the site at the corner of 5th Avenue and 34th Street of the Waldorf Astoria Hotel, once the most popular and fashionable hotel in New York City. It was no longer a fashionable area by 1931. The hotel moved uptown. The old building was torn down, and the Empire State Building went up in its place.
The officers and directors of Empire State Incorporated are on the roof of the old Waldorf Astoria Hotel, about to begin demolition of that ancient and historic structure. Now, gentlemen, stand back while I start the real work of demolition.
With that, Al Smith ceremoniously pulled down the trappings of the exclusive Waldorf Astoria Hotel to clear the way for the Empire State Building. It was quite a moment. The favorite son from the Lower East Side knocking away a symbol of economic segregation erected by the wealthy to replace it with a towering vision of a new America.
I went to work during the demolition of the old Waldorf Astoria Hotel. I was 16 then. The workers were going through this old fancy hotel, you know, and a couple of them came down and says, look, they got urinals for everybody. They were talking about the bidets that were in those fancy hotel rooms.
The future must use the past as its foundation, and the foundation for the Empire State is a history measured in contrasts. A century prior to its days as high society's Waldorf Astoria, playground for the rich and famous, 34th Street and 5th Avenue had been the site of a family farm.
Before Manhattan looked anything like it does now, it was farmland. And there used to be a farm on this site owned by a gentleman named John Thompson. And there was a stream, and he had cows and, you know, all the normal farm things.
As America claimed its independence in 1776, this was the site for a spectacularly unsuccessful Revolutionary War battle.
There was a great deal of battling going on all around New York City. The British landed here with 45,000 troops, which is an enormous number. We only had, we Americans, had 8,000 troops. And Washington was having to fight a delaying action all the time, retreating all the way across what was the rocky little island of Manhattan.
Stories persist that the spot where George Washington tried to physically quit his men from their hasty retreat is exactly where the Empire State Building stands today.
New York City remained in possession of the British all during the Revolution, and I'm sorry to say that the natives of New York were very glad to have the British there. They had lots of parties, they made lots of money off the visitors, and they were somewhat chagrined when it turned out that we, after all, had won the war instead of lost it.
The geological foundation of the Empire State Building is millions of years old, a broad expanse of pure granite bedrock stretching beneath Manhattan. This section of North America's continental plate is nature's sturdiest structural support and what makes skyscrapers possible. Bedrock has largely defined the New York skyline and ensures that Manhattan will never sink under the weight of its buildings. But some say the Empire State Building is also protected by the luck of the Irish, since Al Smith arranged for construction to commence on St. Patrick's Day, March 17, 1930, less than 2 months after excavation. The base of the building is 2 square acres of solid concrete, laid 55 feet below sea level. From this foundation, 60,000 tons of steel frame would extend the building to a height of 1,454 feet, over 102 stories high, more than a quarter mile into the clouds. By the time Al Smith laid the cornerstone on September 17th, only 8 months after the project began, the estimated construction cost was $25 million, half the projected figure due to the effect of the Depression on the value of the dollar.
Well, I think everybody was grateful for the fact that any amount of building was going on in the Depression in New York City, which is why the Empire State Building was continuously looked up to and reported on in the course of its construction. It also was very rapidly built because everybody was eager to be doing work.
The pace was frantic. New innovations in prefabricated materials efficiently assembled by workers allowed the structure to grow an average of 4.5 stories a week. In one astonishing 10-day period, the building rose a record 14 floors. But the real challenge wasn't speed, it was logistics. The steel for the structure, more than a pound for every man, woman, and child then living in the United States, was made in Pittsburgh. Enormous beams fashioned to rigid specifications. The 44-ton columns then loaded onto railroad cars to be shipped nearly 400 miles to the center of Manhattan, reaching there about 3 days later. The delivery timetable was exacting because when you're building in the middle of a bustling city, there's no place to store construction materials. So when a steel beam arrived, it had to be erected immediately. There was simply no place to set it aside. The construction team devised an elaborate system of hoists and internal transport systems to distribute materials throughout the building site. Each piece of steel was carefully marked to show its destination. Then, using cables and pulleys, it was hoisted into position through a series of cranes or derricks. These cranes were then lifted to higher levels as the steelwork rose around them. For an extra measure of speed, temporary rail tracks were installed on each floor to transport smaller materials. Meanwhile, up on the high iron, something you don't see anymore, riveters tossing white-hot steel pellets through the air.
I'm old enough to remember watching guys take the rivets out of the hot bucket and they'll throw it up to the other guy while it's white-hot. And he'll stick it in that open hole and he'll pound it home. And that's the way they built the Empire State Building.
Hot rivets can be molded into the shape of the connecting holes. And when they cool and contract, they tighten the bond between the girders. Today, bolts and screws are the more economic alternative. Being part of this process infused the men with a sense of ownership in the building. They had a special camaraderie. And their pride resonates today, whether they laid plaster, bumped cement, installed radiators, or handled the steel.
I've ran into some people that claim they worked on the Empire State Building. I said, what were you? Oh, I was a plumber. I says, when? He says, 1931. I said, oh, come on, forget it. You didn't work on the Empire State Building during construction. You were after construction. And please, will you mention that in the future?
14 workers fell to their deaths over the construction period as the web of steel frame climbed higher and higher. Meanwhile, interior work raced to keep pace. 18 truckloads of elevator equipment arrived daily for a separate crew of 340 men to install 73 elevators operating in 7 miles of shafts. 10 million bricks, 730 tons of aluminum and stainless steel molding were attached to the exterior. 50 miles of radiator pipe, 70 miles of water pipe, 2.5 million feet of electrical wire, 1,060 miles of telephone cable weave through the building. 6,500 windows form the glass mosaic on the building's surface. 7 million man-hours of work were performed by crews which swelled to nearly 4,000 men. In record time, the Empire State Building was finally completed in just 1 year and 45 days.
They dug the foundations on St. Patrick's Day, 1930, and they capped the building, 1931. Today it takes that long to change a light bulb.
There was a price to pay for rushing construction on the Empire State Building. 14 men died. The Chrysler Building, built more slowly, lost only one worker. Modern marvels will return.
1929, yes, the times were hard, but I had worked as a water boy. I had my mother and three brothers and a sister to take care of. We lived in Brooklyn, so I had to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, have a quick breakfast of a roll and a cup of coffee. That was all we could afford at that time. And then take the nickel subway to 34th Street. To me, it was a big adventure at 16, 17 years old. Come on. I used to make a lot of money in that time. $5 a week plus maybe $5, $6, $7, $8, $9 a week in tips from the steel workers, because I used to throw a little lemonade into their water. At the end of the week, you put put it in a bucket by the paymaster, and whatever they changed they had in their pockets, they would throw in the bucket.
Every man on the job was grateful for a paycheck. Some steel workers made as much as $200 a month. But an equally valuable experience for many of the workers was the chance to learn from their co-workers, like the Mohawk Indians.
The Mohawks, they were the skywalkers, yes. Because wherever there was something big going up, they were there.
Since the mid-1800s, these Native Americans have made high-altitude construction work a part of their tribal rite of passage. They see it as a journey into self and a denial of death, linked to the tradition of courage and grace established by their ancestors. The Mohawks who worked on the Empire State Building live in what is now Quebec. But many spent their lives on a sacred pilgrimage from construction site to construction site, practicing the aerial ritual of connecting girder to girder.
They were fantastic. They walked across those steel beams as if they were nothing. And as I was a young fella, they took me under their wing. And they told me how to do it, how to do it, how to do it. Look, Joe, look across there. Don't look down. Look straight across where you're walking, put one foot behind the other, and we will be behind you if you make a mistake. And I'll tell you, I learned to walk those beams, and I never made a mistake until one time I stepped on a greasy girder, and it slipped on me. That was not my fault or their fault. There was a bit of grease on it. But I'll tell you, they were there so fast, I don't think I was on that girder more than 15 seconds before they had me off. But they said they had to pry me off that beam. But I wasn't hurt. I just scraped my legs a little bit. And then I went downstairs and I told the foreman, I'm not going back up there. He says, the hell you're not. He says, you're going back up there or you're fired. I said, why? He said, if you don't go back up there tomorrow, you're never going back today. You're never going to go back there tomorrow. I'll tell you, he was good. He really proved something to me that, look, you don't back away from something. and I've never backed away from anything since.
While the Mohawks had their eyes on the heavens, Al Smith had his eyes focused on a competing construction project a few short blocks away, the brand new Chrysler Building. To some, the Chrysler Building had a more contemporary look that played off the image of its automotive backer. Traditional Gothic gargoyles were replaced with stylized hood ornaments. The surface was festooned with hubcap medallions. But far more disturbing for Al Smith was that the building proved to be an architectural Trojan horse. The Art Deco spire was secretly constructed inside the building and erected as a surprise addition, bringing its height to 1,046 feet, only 4 feet short of the Empire State's proposed height. So Al Smith and his board of directors insisted their building also wear a hat. They would build an observatory and dirigible mooring mast 200 more feet. That the Chrysler Building could never surpass.
These are celebratory tops. They express a willful human gesture. They remind you that, okay, maybe a machine made it, but a man designed it, and a man had the last word, and he put this wonderful little signature on the top of it. It sort of reasserts the importance of the human touch.
There are stories that Al Smith actually climbed to the top of the Empire State Building the night before its grand opening and left his signature somewhere inside the hi-hat he inspired. At that point, he was not a politician. He was not a businessman. He was just a kid from the Lower East Side who had reached the top. And as he left his humble mark of graffiti, he forever linked himself to the American dream. There are 6,500 windows in the Empire State Building. All get cleaned twice a month. Window washers qualify for combat pay. Modern Marvels will return in a moment.
Governor, we are on the top of the 86th floor of the Empire State Building. The highest point in the world today that can be reached from a building designed, fashioned, built by the brain, the brawn, the ingenuity, and the muscle of mankind.
I am very happy to take part in this very auspicious occasion with my old friend, Governor Smith.
On May 1st, 1931, after a VIP ceremony atop the building, Al Smith gave his grandchildren the honor of cutting the ceremonial ribbon across the front doors. Hundreds of miles away in Washington, D.C., President Hoover pressed a button that lit the power of the world's largest building, and the Empire State Building was open for business.
When it was finished, it was almost totally unoccupied. There were no tenants.
I can remember the governor, Al Smith. I can remember him very well, chomping on his cigar and wearing his little brown derby. We won first name calling. He called me Jack, and I called him Governor, because we were about the only two people in the building. There were very few other tenants. They had boards in the lobby. The terrazzo hadn't even been put in. The building was only opened up to the 20th floor on the inside. Of course, the outside was completed.
At first, the building's high-tech dirigible mooring station was seen as an attraction for international merchants who traveled on those giant European airships.
Unfortunately, people had overlooked the fact that New York has canyons, man-made canyons, but canyons. And in canyons, you have wind. So that the two times the dirigibles were moored here, or there was an attempt made to moor the dirigibles, they were upended.
Al Smith called reporters to cover the first airship delivery of the Daily News. It was dropped by rope, but celebrities attending the event had to scramble to avoid getting swept off the... building.
The darn thing went up and stood almost vertically on its nose before they were able to get it back down.
The 1937 explosion of the Hindenburg at Lakehurst, New Jersey finally convinced management that dirigibles had no place over the Empire State Building. Smith, meanwhile, was trying to attract tenants with any kind of publicity stunt he could come up with.
I don't know about the 10-gallon hat, but the accompaniment is okay.
But rooftop press conferences and stunts weren't enough to lure people to the building. Ironically, it was not beauty, but a beast who would capture the world's imagination.
But it became the scene of the great climactic part of the movie King Kong. It became immortal all over the world. So the people all over the world came to New York, bent upon seeing the Empire State Building if they saw nothing else.
At last, the Empire State Building was becoming fashionable.
Particularly this neighborhood became the center of the fashion and garment industry. That was really the bulk of our tenants, were fashion and garment-related industries. And the building filled rapidly, and it became an address that people sought. We used to have an ad that said, you don't need the address, just say it's the Empire State Building.
With the Empire State as its emblem, New York once again assumed its big city crown and committed itself to the future, offering to lead the nation into the world of tomorrow. But America would soon realize that the world of tomorrow was a world at war, a nightmare of sneak attacks, death camps, tyrants, and terror. Yet through these tumultuous times, the Empire State Building seemed to project stability and reassurance of the nation's strength.
I think many people saw this as a symbol of hope, as a symbol of what America could do and what America would come back to.
That stability was literally put to the test on a foggy morning in 45.
The Empire State Building and all New York City were wrapped in fog as a B-25 Mitchell bomber trying to reach a nearby airport crashed into the tallest structure in the world. 13 were killed, including the three in the plane. The Empire State Building's 79th floor was hardest hit by the crash after the bomber's pilot lost his bearings and tried unsuccessfully to bank away from the skyscraper. With elevators out of order, firemen had to drag their hoses many stories high to fight the flames spread by gasoline and oil. Disaster units respond to the emergency call. When the plane hit the building's north side, parts of it were jammed into the walls. Others plummeted down elevator shafts. Still others crashed through seven consecutive walls and out the south side, causing damage to nearby buildings. One elevator fell 80 floors, but its girl operator miraculously escaped death. 950 feet above the street, repairs are begun on New York's 102-story skyscraper.
I called my office, and the girl that answered the phone was hysterical. They said, they're bombing the building. So I said, who's bombing? She said, the Japs. So I said, where are they bombing you from? She says, I don't know, but she says the building's burning down. And I said, put somebody else on them. I thought she would have gone berserk. You see, there's a map below the Sox, which shows you where the building is, which is on the corner of 34th and 5th Avenue. Our office is approximately halfway up on the 66th floor, and the plane hit the building on the 34th Street side, right up here at the 79th floor. The office it hit was the Catholic Charities office on the 79th floor, and I don't believe anybody was working there on Saturday. Fortunately, it happened on a Saturday.
A few decades earlier, there was a fear that wind could topple tall structures. The Empire State Building proved its solid construction could withstand far more than that. With the tragedy of the airplane collision, the public's perception of the building finally found a consensus. The Empire State was no longer a novelty, a new kid on the block. It was now a full-fledged New Yorker, big, bold, confident, with uptown style and downtown attitude.
I always look at the building like a ship. It's big, 2.25 million square feet. It certainly has 2.25 million people coming to the observatory every year and 20,000 people a day to come here to do business.
This modern marvel is such a part of New York that today it feels as though the Empire State Building has always been there. The Empire State Building is one of the greatest lightning rods ever built, allegedly when conditions are right. and the 86th floor is surrounded by static electricity, if you kiss someone, fire will fly from your lips. Modern Marvels will be right back.
There's a wonderful story about the three men that are laying bricks. They're asked, well, what are you doing here? And the first man says, make a living. They ask the second man, and he says, building a wall. The third man, when asked the question, what are you doing, answers, I'm building a cathedral.
For the men who built the Empire State Building, making a living was foremost in their minds. But building a monument with a vision of tomorrow was in their hearts. Their commitment to America and its future is the very soul of the Empire State, a modern city within a city, and their dreams and dedication are celebrated in the Art Deco design of the five-story lobby. Giant bronze medallions proclaim the contributions of various craftspeople, and a towering metal mosaic positions the building as the center of the universe. The walls are a work of art in their own right. Experts combed Europe to locate the finest marble. In one case, an entire quarry was reserved to ensure a consistent source for the proper color and grain. For many years after its opening in the depths of the Depression, the Empire State Building was referred to as the Empty State Building, a wry acknowledgement of its embarrassing lack of tenants. But today, under the management of Helmsley Spear, the building has its own zip code, and the lobby directory boasts full occupancy, housing nearly 1,000 businesses from every continent on Earth. Servicing tenants requires an elaborate infrastructure of maintenance which begins 55 feet below street level, where concrete meets bedrock. Marks on the walls indicate where the ancient stream beneath the building occasionally rises, still waiting to irrigate John Thompson's long-forgotten farm. Bob Noble, chief engineer, supervises an army of workers who comb the building's dark labyrinths to constantly monitor the structure's electrical, heating, lighting, and phone systems. Maintenance of the Empire State continues through its towering pinnacle, capping the building's 102 floors. Where dirigibles once hoped to land, now stands a TV transmission antenna erected in 1950, which by itself is as tall as a 20-story building.
Right now we're at the top of the Empire State Building. This is as close to heaven as you're going to get.
Inside the supporting tower are banks of light, some of them colored, that bathe the building in brilliant hues during holidays and special events. But this ornate lighting also attracts some disoriented travelers.
During the migratory season, if we had a foggy night, the birds would become confused with the lighting and the clouds. And they would actually hit into the building, and we would find, unfortunately, a number of birds that never made it to the destination. And what we started doing is, certain times of the year, we knew that the birds would be migrating, and if we turned off the lights, except for those lights that were required for airplanes, that they didn't become confused.
The interior of the spire, shielded from the public, is the domain of generations of nameless workers who have left their anonymous marks on the walls and girders. These are messages to the future. Outside the tower, nature adopts bizarre behavior. Exterior workers occasionally complain of being bombarded by tiny pellets as they're suspended high above street level. Scientists have discovered that the men are being struck by barley, blown in from windstorms in the Midwest. And in the winter, they report another strange phenomenon.
Because of the updraft, it actually snows up when you're up there. So you see the snow kind of above you coming down, and then all of a sudden it's blowing back up. And it's really unusual. I never saw it snow up before.
The top of the Empire State is ringed with powerful microwave transmitters. The static interference you see in these pictures is the result of radiation coursing through the camera, and of course through the cameraman. The sense of being on top of the world and seeing forever is what draws people to the building's observation deck on the 86th floor.
Going up, going down.
Well, it's the end of our honeymoon, so we thought we'd top it by going up one of the tallest buildings in the world.
Anyway, it's romantic on your honeymoon, isn't it? If I'm going to be in New York City, I've got to get the Empire State Building, so here we are.
Oh, man, it's a great high. See how high I am? Oh,
I think we like to look down on things. It makes you feel slightly less insignificant, slightly less small.
When people reach this height, they look out on a vista that extends for 80 miles, peering over and into New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Connecticut, Massachusetts, and straight down into the lush urban jungle.
Architecture is the means that a city has to say, here I am, here I stand, this is what I represent. The Empire State Building has become the quintessential symbol of New York, but not so much for architectural reasons, as simply as the symbol of the might of the city. It is superlative in that it's the biggest of its kind, and everybody in New York thinks New York ought to have the biggest of whatever it may be.
The Empire State Building is as much an experience as it is an assembly of bricks and steel. It brings people together for what it represents about the American will and holds them in its grasp with a sheer sense of awe and wonder.
I think it's the most beautiful building in the world. Never mind the Taj Mahal or without any of them. This is my lady of Fifth Avenue, the greatest lady of Fifth Avenue, and always will be.
Marks on the walls indicate where the ancient stream beneath the building occasionally rises, still waiting to irrigate John Thompson's long-forgotten farm. Bob Noble, chief engineer, supervises an army of workers who comb the building's dark labyrinths to constantly monitor the structure's electrical, heating, lighting, and phone systems. Maintenance of the Empire State continues through its towering pinnacle, capping the building's 102 floors. Where dirigibles once hoped to land, now stands a TV transmission antenna erected in 1950, which by itself is as tall as a 20-story building.
Right now we're at the top of the Empire State Building. This is as close to heaven as you're going to get.
Inside the supporting tower are banks of light, some of them colored, that bathe the building in brilliant hues during holidays and special events. But this ornate lighting also attracts some disoriented travelers.
During the migratory season, if we had a foggy night, the birds would become confused with the lighting and the clouds. And they would actually hit into the building, and we would find, unfortunately, a number of birds that never made it to the destination. And what we started doing is, certain times of the year, we knew that the birds would be migrating, and if we turned off the lights, except for those lights that were required for airplanes, that they didn't become confused.
The interior of the spire, shielded from the public, is the domain of generations of nameless workers who have left their anonymous marks on the walls and girders. These are messages to the future. Outside the tower, nature adopts bizarre behavior. Exterior workers occasionally complain of being bombarded by tiny pellets as they're suspended high above street level. Scientists have discovered that the men are being struck by barley, blown in from windstorms in the Midwest. And in the winter, they report another strange phenomenon.
Because of the updraft, it actually snows up when you're up there. So you see the snow kind of above you coming down, and then all of a sudden it's blowing back up. And it's really unusual. I never saw it snow up before.
The top of the Empire State is ringed with powerful microwave transmitters. The static interference you see in these pictures is the result of radiation coursing through the camera, and of course through the cameraman. The sense of being on top of the world and seeing forever is what draws people to the building's observation deck on the 86th floor.
Going up, going down.
Well, it's the end of our honeymoon, so we thought we'd top it by going up some of the tallest buildings in the world.
Anyway, it's romantic on your honeymoon, isn't it? If I'm going to be in New York City, I've got to get the Empire State Building, so here we are.
Oh, man, it's a great high. See how high I am? Oh,
I think we like to look down on things. It makes you feel slightly less insignificant, slightly less small.
When people reach this height, they look out on a vista that extends for 80 miles, peering over and into New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Connecticut, Massachusetts, and straight down into the lush urban jungle.
Architecture is the means that a city has to say, here I am, here I stand, this is what I represent. The Empire State Building has become the quintessential symbol of New York, but not so much for architectural reasons, is simply as the symbol of the might of the city. It is superlative in that it's the biggest of its kind, and everybody in New York thinks New York ought to have the biggest of whatever it may be.
The Empire State Building is as much an experience as it is an assembly of bricks and steel. It brings people together for what it represents about the American will and holds them in its grasp with a sheer sense of awe and wonder.
I think it's the most beautiful building in the world. Never mind the Taj Mahal or without any of them. This is my lady of Fifth Avenue, the greatest lady of Fifth Avenue, and always will be.